like radiant diamonds bursting inside us. We cannot contain. Your love will surely come find us like blazing wildfire.
Worship. Kelly Prankers.
Oh, Lord, be worshiped now. Lord, you are worshiped just then. Be worshiped now, God. Be worshiped by truth being presented and truth being savored and truth being enjoyed. Please, God, for our good, for our salvation, for our happiness in you, God. Please, and for your glory. For your glory, God. Amen. Amen. Okay. Who? My name is Jones, and I teach here. So funny, man. I spoke at Jell's Chapel last year, and now I'm a teacher. So that's who I am. I am married to the most amazing, wonderful, incredible person in the entire world, and she's my love, my life, my superhero. I've got the four cutest kids, cuter than anybody else's kids here. No offense, maybe. And I love my kiddos. I love my job. Man, y'all, I love being a teacher. I love the school. I was a student here, kindergarten through 12th grade. So I smugly stuck up my nose to all you just people that started in first grade, the 12-year club. That's a 15-year club. So we're all 14-year clubs. Any 14-year? Yes, yeah, I'm a judge right now, right here. But I love getting to go here, and I love getting to teach here. It has been an absolute joy of mine to be here for the past year. Teach juniors, love the juniors, love you guys, and I'm 8th grade, I love them, love the goobers, and I love them. So it's just been great being back here. So today, I want to talk about love. I love talking about love. Why? God's confession. I am a hopeless romantic. Like, horribly so, like weirdly, shockingly, hopeless romantic. I'm obsessed with my wife. I'm hopelessly in love with her. I'm a sap. I am a poor sap. True story. I cry just about every bachelor, bachelorette, final rose ceremony. Don't judge me too much right now. I know you're judging right now. It's okay. But seriously, I cry a lot of that. Jack, you cry too? That Jill, we're both Jack. Don't cry for this one. I cry at those things because I love, and that's just not love. We can watch those shows. That's not love. But I cry, and I'm like, oh, maybe this one will have a chance. Nope, I don't. Actually, some of them. But I am a hopeless romantic. In fact, it started from when I was a wee little lad. I've got way too many stories about it. But let me tell you one good one. Middle school. There was a girl, let's just call her name Sarah. Sarah, 7th grade, she caught my eye. And I was about the size of that, and she was about the size of that, so I don't think she didn't catch me, because she just couldn't see me. I was so short. I was like the shortest kid in the grade. I had a twin brother, we were the shortest kids. We were loud and short, not a good combination. I had this massive crush, and so back then we took pictures by one of those trees out in the grove, is that what we call it? School picture, you can look in the yearbook, where we leaned against the tree, that was a school picture, and I still remember her, she leaned against the tree, and you know, we got the, she had this scrunchie, this green scrunchie, it was a forest green, subdued forest green scrunchie, I remember that. So what you did, I don't know if y'all still do this, but you get the pictures back, the photos, you cut them out, and you swap them, and so I was just trying. I think I asked. I'm sure I asked her because I was old enough and crazy enough to do that. But I'm sure I stole a few of my time as well. So later that year, I somehow came in possession of this green scrunchie. I don't know if I like forcibly took it off of her arm when she wasn't looking, or if she accidentally dropped it and I took it. And I kept it underneath my bed. And I would pull it out every so often and go, you didn't judge me over the bachelorette, you judge me now. You know, are you Lord of the Rings fans? True story. Smells, man, smells sticky. I can still tell you what the smell was on my 9th grade Valentine's Day. It's here. First blood dance. So I had this. this girl had this massive crush on. And so I, going into eighth grade here, my voice went from really high to a nice and good solid deep voice, if you know what I'm saying. And so eighth grade here, first day of school, I'm running through the cafeteria. She went to get in line. I get behind her. I went, when I practice this, I went, "Hey, Sarah." she turned around and went, "Rob? Robert?" Yeah. Imagine turning around.
Robert?
I had not grown yet, but my voice was deep. I was like, "What?" She's like, "Say that, say my name." "What, Sarah? What? What are you talking about?" And so I wanted her to see me in God's love. So later that, a few weeks later, it was my turn to read the vocab list out loud in eighth grade class, Coach Carew. And I practiced this list with my deepest, manliest voice, and I did it. It was awesome, except for the last word, boys. I'll never forget that word. Me and that word have a love-hate relationship, because I got to that word, and I went, "Boys!" You know, shattered. The whole class started dying laughing. Me and I know who Drew Holcomb is. He's obnoxious. He fell down off of his desk and was going because my voice cracked so bad. And what do you think I did standing up there, 3'2", you know, just, I don't think I started crying. I got super red, super embarrassed, shame. Sarah, she stood up for me and she went, "How dare you?" I can't remember what she said next, but something like, "At least his voice did change," or something like that. But I started thinking, she stood up for me and she called me out. I was like, "Wouldn't marry him right now. Here's the scrunchie, you know." I keep it with me these days. I was just like, "Oh my gosh." Yep. The whole class saw me at my weakest, at my shame, at my utter vulnerability. I was totally known, totally naked in front of them. And they laughed at me. They said, "You have weak." "Nope." And she said, "Yes." She said, "I will defend you. I see you and I will love you." And it was a powerful, powerful moment in my life, as you can tell. Well, things didn't work out for me, Sarah. Although I tried, but it didn't work out. That's okay. What's she doing now? I don't know. I love my wife. Why I say those kind of things. People are asking, "Did you ever keep track of your old people she dated or your old flames?" I'm like, "No. No. Why would I do that?" Because the heart, my human heart, has the propensity to wonder. Prone to wonder, Lord, I feel I'm not above an affair. I'm not above that. Well, I don't want to go checking in Facebook feeds or Instagrams of my old girls that I used to love and thought they were the one from college or even high school. Why would I do that? Why would I tempt myself like that? Because I'm human, I'm sinful. That's why I don't do it. Because I love my wife. And I love the glory of God, how that is intertwined in my marriage with my wife. That's why I don't do it. Because I have before. Not out of a desire to start some wrong relationship, but just out of a wandering mind. I said, I can't do this. That's why I made that comment. What's she doing now? I don't know. I don't care what that girl's doing right now. I care about my wife. So I want to talk about our desire for love. As humans, we love to be loved. God has designed your heart to be that way. Has he not? To want to be loved. That's why many of you today are thinking of that simple question that haunts you. Sometimes, maybe today, maybe at night, does someone love me? Does someone like me? Am I lovable? Am I likable? I struggled with that all throughout middle school and high school. Because no girl ever liked me. Why did I marry Kim? Because she's the first girl that actually liked me back. True story. But I was desperate for that. Some of you, it's not that significant other, it's that parent. It's that teacher, it's that coach. It's that friend. Want to be loved, want to be accepted. That is our greatest longing, is to be known, fully known, that they know me, they see me, they truly see me, and they say yes. That is our greatest desire. And since that is our greatest desire and our greatest longing, therefore is also the source of our greatest fear. that someone sees you, all of you, knows you for you, and says, no thanks. That is our greatest fear. Because that's happened. That happens to us. Someone sees our imperfection. Someone hears our cracked voices. Sees our weird body things that we try to cover up. Sees the quirks in our personalities. And they say, no. Fully known and not loved. That is our fear. I am fully known, but I am not loved. My students, juniors, hope you don't mind. We did this assignment called the Do You See Me assignment. We just finished studying a book where a man was devalued and disrespected and felt less than because of the color of his skin. I said, okay, we've all had this moment. We've all felt this, not to that same extent. In that way, some yes, for sure. But when have you felt devalued? When have you felt not seen? And so I asked them to write a poem that when they wrote these to express that hurt, to express that pain, to express that triumph, to express whatever it was that they needed to express, to work through of do you see me? And I read these things and I cried over them. I got angry over them. So sad over them. It was so powerful. My juniors, man, you gave yourselves to that, and it was awesome. It was awesome. And so much, and in those assignments, it was so much fear and so much hurt. So hard to read something because there's just that's the human experience. Because we cannot fully and truly love someone because we're sinful, because we're broken, because we're rejected. So because our greatest fear is to be known and be rejected, we begin to hide. We think we need to act a certain way, dress a certain way, do things on social media to prove something. We strive to put forth some image, walking around on social media, whatever. The cars that we drive, the clothes that we wear, the words that we say. Because we want to hide. We want to hide that quirk, that trait. You know, that makes us, that's someone that we show to somebody once. We kind of went, hey, I'm going to show this to you. And they just laughed. I see it happen in my classroom all the time. Middle and high school. I still see it happen with my friends. I see it happen in my church. We show bits of ourselves, and they kind of just do something. They just go, ooh. And every time we see them, we have this inner dialogue, this inner narrative, thinking, I wonder if they're thinking about that. I wonder if they're judging me for that. I wonder if that's what they're thinking about, they're reminding themselves of that. Maybe they're not, but that's what we tell ourselves. We all have inner dialogues that go on constantly. But a group that is rooted in this fear of being rejected. I couldn't have confessed to anybody that I watched The Bachelor in high school. I would have been too ashamed to do so. I'm not ashamed now. Maybe I should be. My whole high school would be like, you told them what? Yeah, that wasn't in the notes to tell you all that. So what is the... what does the Bible say? What does the Bible say about this desire to be fully known and fully loved? The Bible is full of it because the Bible is a love story. And of course, the first time I heard that, I was like, yes, it's a love story. First year, my head pastor said that. I was like, it's a love story. I love love. Genesis 1. Genesis 2, actually, is where we get this first part of Adam and Eve's, their story of God's creation of the world. But God's creation of Adam and Eve and God's creation of the institution of marriage, of relationship, of friendship. Genesis 2:21 says this, so the Lord God caused a deep sleep to fall upon the man, and while he slept, God took one of the man's ribs and closed up his place with flesh. And the rib and the Lord and the rib that the Lord God had taken from the man, he made into a woman. And he brought her to the man. Then the man said, this is at last bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman because she was taken out of man. Therefore, verse 24, a man shall leave his father and mother and hold fast to his wife, and they shall become one flesh. They hold fast to his wife, and they shall become one flesh. Verse 25, and the man and his wife were both naked and were not ashamed. They were both naked and not ashamed. There's so much in this passage that we can spend forever on, but we can't. Some quick observations. you can think this is cheesy or not, but I do think that you see when God created this institution of marriage, you do see what marital love looks like in this. You do see a marriage. You do see God creating Adam, putting him to sleep when he starts to create Eve, and then God walks Eve to Adam, in a sense performing the first marriage ceremony. So I've got three daughters. Someday, if that's the Lord's will in their life, I'm going to be walking my daughters down to some jabros at the end of the aisle. I'm going to have a hammer just go, boink, you know, say, let's keep walking. You know, because I love my daughters, and don't want them to marry some idiot. But no, I already prayed for that. But we see that God brought Eve down. Can you see the first love poem? Bone of my bones. Adam looks at her. And what does he do? And in the Hebrew, it's a poem. Bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. This is Adam proclaiming that she is a part of it. A close, intense relationship. A deep connection. A belonging to one another. I know who I am because of you. You complete me. Steal that line. Where's the movie that from? You Jerry Maguire, right? You complete me. That's the idea. That's what Adam was saying. But let's get to verse 25. We've got to go. Because it has this foundational major description of biblical love. Naked and unashamed. Totally seen. Totally vulnerable. But no fear. Love. Adam and Eve could stand before each other naked in every sense of the word. Physically, emotionally, spiritually, psychologically. And there was no shame. No fear because there's love. There's no sin. But then Genesis 3 happens. Sin from the evil without, the evil within, comes into the garden. They're tempted, they fall, and sin enters God's perfect world. It enters their hearts, and sin immediately starts wreaking havoc. You see the first marriage fight, they don't have time to go into, where they play the blame game. Adam says, God, it's this woman that you gave me, that's why we're having these problems. And immediately they start to fight. I read verse 7 through 10. It says this, though. Then the eyes of both were opened, and they knew that they were naked. And they sewed fig leaves together and made themselves loincloths. And they heard the sound of the Lord God walking in the garden in the cool of the day. And the man and his wife hid themselves from the presence of the Lord God among the trees of the garden. But the Lord God called to the man and said to him, where are you? And the man said, I heard the sound of you in the garden, and I was afraid because I was naked, and I hid myself. So the first thing we see is that Adam and Eve, that as soon as sin comes in, they realize they're naked, and they cover themselves from each other. They went, oh, you can't see this anymore. And Adam starts to fight. Because there's now sin, there's no longer perfect love, there's no longer unconditional love, and so I gotta hide. And so this word naked that was used in a beautiful, perfect way in chapter 2, all of a sudden in chapter 3, verse 7, it takes on a whole new meaning. Naked, pre-sin, no shame. Naked, post-sin, shame. And every time that the word naked, the Hebrew word for naked, is used in the Old Testament, from then on out, it's always connected to shame. It's always connected to something negative, something bad. Isn't that fascinating? We want to be fully known and fully loved, but because of sin, we have to cover up and hide from each other. We can't let each other hurt. And it breaks us down and hurts. But what does the gospel say? Oh, man. This is the greatest love story. What is interesting, we see with Adam and Eve's relationship, it is not just about their relationship. Genesis 3 is not about just about their relationship. In fact, their relationship is a picture similar to the cosmic relationship of the spiritual relationship with God, their relationship with God, and our relationship with God. Before sin, Adam and Eve enjoyed a perfect relationship with God. They were fully known by God and fully loved. They had unhindered, joyful access to Him. It was a beautiful love. Can you imagine it? But after sin, not only is Adam and Eve's relationship tainted, more importantly, their relationship with God is broken, is tainted. And what do you see? They cover themselves up from each other. But then what do? They hear the sound. God walking in the garden. They go, hey, God, just like they always used to do. Nope. They hid. They hid from him. And God says, where are you? And he says, I'm scared. I heard you coming, so I hid myself because I'm scared. What do you think that must have done to God's heart, to his children he just created? Right? Rocket. That's when my kids get in trouble. They go hide. Adam's saying, don't look at me, God. I'm broken. I'm ruined. I'm ashamed. I'm naked. You can't look at me anymore, God. Avert your eyes, please. Because of sin, no one can stand before God fully known and fully loved. Because of sin, no one, none of us, can stand before God fully known and fully loved in our sin. There's no such thing anymore as naked and not ashamed. And they felt shame. They felt fear. It's the good news. The gospel. God had a plan. He had planned this out of this great love story for his glory. Salvation was planned so we could say, whoa, you love us. And he had a great redemption plan because God loved his people. He loved his Christians so much he would not leave them in their sin and their shame. Sin would not stop God from loving his people. Your love will surely come find me. As we just sang, those aren't just words. His love finds us. It pursues us. It tracks us down. And it comes for us day after day. Do you know when nakedness is reversed? When the shame of nakedness is reversed? At the cross. At the cross. Because what did Jesus do at the cross? Are you bored with the cross? If you're bored with it, you don't get it. You don't know it. At the cross, Jesus stood naked in his absolute purity, stood naked before the world. Nailed open. How can you be more vulnerable than that? Naked before the world. And he took our shame, and he took our sin, and he took our fears, and he took our weaknesses, and he became it. As it tells us in Corinthians, he became sin for us. What? Isn't that beautiful? I hope I get to talk about this for the rest of my life. Oh, it's so beautiful. He washed it away with his blood. His blood covers our sin. What love. So now, through faith in Christ, through repenting of our sins, putting them on Jesus, Jesus died for my sins, and putting our faith in him, we can now stand before God naked and unashamed. Why can I confess to you anything? I'll confess to you because God loves me. And whether you think I'm crazy or weird or stupid or shameful or not, it does not matter to an extent. We've got to qualify that. We don't have time to qualify that. But before God, I am naked and I am loved. I'm accepted. My first day of school here, I was just so nervous. I didn't hardly sleep. I'm so scared. Am I going to be good teacher? My students going to like me? I had such a love my education here. Can I fall in line with that? Be a good teacher? I was so scared. You know the thought that came to me? It was this. It was the gospel. It doesn't matter what they think of me. If I'm really bad and I get fired, okay, I told you this. Okay. Because God loves me. The gospel isn't some pie-in-the-sky idea that never affects you. Teachers, it's the same for us, is it not? It's not some pie-in-the-sky that we just talk about in our lectures or in our classrooms. It is real and practical because I thought that God gave me that reminder of the gospel. And I just like, so I can speak, I can live, I can love, I can teach in all my weaknesses and imperfections. But Jesus says, you're mine. This is love. We stand before God as sinners. And all of our sin, we try to hide. All the brokenness that's been done to us, we stand before God all the time through faith in Christ. what you do through most of the day or at night time when you're by yourself is you just play through these weaknesses, these sins, these quirks, these things that we try to hide, these things that you expose yourself to somebody who you were hurt by it. So maybe it's the evil of their sin has hurt you, and that's just you're angry by their sin, but also you've internalized it, or you internalize the rejection of a boyfriend or girlfriend. And what is your inner dialogue like? Where is your gaze at this morning? On your sin and your shame, or on God's love for you? So there's a story of this girl. She's in middle school, and she was at this class. She was the girl that people picked on. She was the girl that just didn't fit in. And so the teacher goes out of the room, and they, in the cruel way that we can be at times, the students turn cruel on her. Some start making, said a little joke about her. And they all kind of got a laugh. Oh, that's kind of like, oh, let's go write down what we don't like about her. And they went up one by one and started writing down what they didn't like about this girl. So she devastates her. Can you imagine that? So she runs up crying. Well, fast forward 40 years later, and this girl is now a woman, as broken as ever. She's been seeing her Christian counselor for a while, because the havoc that has wreaked in her life for decades is so palpable to her. Christian counselor says, you've got to relive this moment. Relive it. Tell me exactly again. He's like, no, please don't make me do this. Yes, relive it. Relive it. Tell me. Here's a board. Write it up. She goes to the board, her hands are shaking, she starts to write, and she remembered every word. Short legs, funny laugh, overweight, thinks too much, cares too much about school, has a weird dad. She remembered every one that they listed out. And she is just in a, she falls, she's in a stupor, and all of her tears sobbing over it just because it's still so hard for her. The counselor says, I get it. Don't let me tell you what the gospel is. And she goes up. It's a different color marker. And it writes M-I-N-E, my. That's what God thinks about you. That is beautiful. Doesn't take away our weaknesses. It doesn't take them. Doesn't take our pain away. He just says, "Mind." He says, "Forgiven in Christ." I think about what you guys are going through. I think about what I've gone through. I just think, "Mind, God, perfect." He says, mine, fully known, fully loved, period. That's the gospel. That's the gospel. I need it. Every teacher in this room needs it. You need it. We need it daily. Christ through faith in Him.
Sing that again.
My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly trust in Jesus. Seems to hide His face, I rest on His unchanging grace. In every high and stormy gale, my anchor holds within. Trumpet sound, oh, may I then in Him be found, dressed in His righteousness alone, faultless I stand before. Savior's love.
Mr. Jones, you want to come up here and pray for us again? One more time.
Dear God, I just pray again, Lord. And God, will you do something, God? Please. Lord, I'm your child. I'm asking for a good gift from you, God. Lord, you want to save. You want to heal. Lord, do that now. Please, God. Where are you, God? That's the cry so much in the Psalms, even from Christ. Lord, God, we need you. Work now, God. Work. Please, God. Please work, God. Please work.